Welcome back. In the previous section, we looked at some generic aspects of financing. We saw the considerations for deciding whether to invest or not. This is the investment decision. Subsequently, we saw the considerations on how to fund that investment. This is the financing decision. All that is equally true for project finance. However, now we will start to focus on specific aspects of project finance. The aspects that set it apart from generic financing. In this video, we will look closer at those aspects. We need to distinguish project finance from corporate finance. In corporate finance, a company funds all its activities. Imagine the company Engie, the second largest power company in the world. It raises financing by issuing share capital and corporate loans. It uses this funding for a wide range of worldwide activities. This includes gas distribution in Europe, the generation of nuclear power in France, and the provision of energy engineering services in Europe, amongst other things. The corporate funding is not specifically traceable for one particular investment. If we want to assess the quality of the cash flows, then this will be impossible to analyze the specific use of the funds, because the flows are far too diverse and complex. Lenders and investors necessarily need to look at the big picture, so at how Engie is doing overall. Also, the criteria and ratios they look at to assess their investment need to focus on the overall picture. On the other hand, in project finance, the financing is very specifically related to a particular project. This makes it easier for investors and lenders to assess the cash flows and risks of the project. In project finance, the distance between the investors and the project is much smaller than in corporate finance. Because of this, project managers will need to deal with requirements of the investors and lenders, almost on a day-to-day basis. That is why project managers need to have a good understanding of investors' considerations. The linking of the financing to the project is achieved by undertaking both the project and the financing. This is done through what is called a special purpose vehicle, or SPV. That SPV is a company that undertakes the entire project. It has no other activities than the project. We'll see later on what legal benefits this has. So imagine that Engie decides that it wants to undertake a new power project. For example, building a large solar farm in the Netherlands. Once successful, the solar farm may be expected to sell its electricity through the Dutch public grid. As it is a very large farm, Engie might expect its development to cost many millions of dollars. Engie now has two choices: to fund this investment from its corporate funding, or to seek dedicated funding for this through a project financing. In case number two, Engie will undertake the project through an SPV. This way, the project will be self-financing, in the sense that the funding is directly linked to the success of the solar farm development and its future operations. This success depends on whether the electricity buyer, which is an operator on the public grid, is a financially sound company. Furthermore, the success is connected to the fact that Engie has been successfully responsible for the development and operation of such farms for many years already. These are all signals that make it likely that dedicated lenders will be keen to lend to that SPV. An additional convincing argument is the fact that Engie can attract a high proportion of project loans. For example, this could be 75% of the total project investment, and at a relatively low cost of, say, only 2% interest per year. Project financing this also means that Engie does not need to strain its corporate funding. In other words, it can use that corporate funding for other purposes. For example, it can spend these resources to the research and development of new energy sources and sites. Now we go back to the SPV. Because the SPV has independent legal rights and obligations, it can separate its project funding and cash flows. The SPV is at the heart of the project. All contracts and activities and cash flows run through it. This provides the SPV a so-called legal ring fence, or in other words, a separation of what is inside the project and what is outside. In this way, the SPV serves as a kind of fire door. It keeps the fire from spreading if something goes wrong. If the owners of the company run into financial difficulty, this does not easily pull down the project. And if the project runs into difficulty, the project owners are not easily pulled down either. Whilst it is attractive that lenders have a clear project structure that they can assess, the legal separation also means that they cannot go after any value outside of the ring fence if the project fails. We say that the funding is limited recourse. This means that lenders cannot seek compensation outside of the ring fence. In our example, the project lenders cannot go after ENGIE. They do not have any claim over its worldwide assets, activities, or funds. This limited recourse makes it of paramount importance that the project is clearly and thoroughly organized. The standardized framework of project finance has been developed to achieve this. The framework embodies years of experience and thereby gives a useful framework for project management. There is yet another useful feature of the standardized framework of project finance, namely, the ability to reuse the knowledge and experience that has been built up in projects. Projects are usually one-time events for the project sponsors. They don't usually get the chance to reuse that knowledge and experience. And thanks to that project finance, the teams that work on a transaction can come together for other projects. And oftentimes they do so. Additional course material describes the standardized project finance structure in more detail and explains what parties are involved. The relevant course material will be available to you online. Let me point out here the key role of the project sponsor. It is the party who designs and develops the project, and who is usually the key equity investor. It is the party that subscribes to the share capital that the SPV issues. It provides the equity funding and bears the project risk. ENGIE would be the project sponsor in the project example we just used. So during this video, we've seen a few aspects of project financing. Firstly, project finance is undertaken through a special purpose company. Secondly, the SPV is a limited recourse financing thanks to the project ring fencing. And thirdly, the structure is standardized, thorough and successful. Another aspect that is worth mentioning is the fact that the project asset that will be built is specific in nature. For example, project financing can be organized for building a road or a power plant. In general, a lender of funds usually requires the security of certain assets from the borrower. For example, a mortgage on a house or building. We call this security a collateral. This collateral serves to recover the loan in case it is not repaid. In project finance, the execution value of the project asset is usually much lower than the funding, due to its specific nature. Importantly, there is usually not an active market for emergency sales of stretches of road or power plants. We are still able to borrow at such attractive terms with project finance despite the low security value of collateral. That is also a testament to the success of this methodology. Rather than on collateral, project finance focuses on the stability and continuation of the project cash flows. As long as these project cash flows continue, we will have no need to force an emergency sale of the collateral. Thanks for listening and see you soon.